the leader of the Muslims. This was a new problem. They had never faced it at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At the same time, there was no clear verse which stated that this is the man that should become the leader of the Muslims after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nor was there a clear hadith which stated in clear words that this is the man that should become the leader of the Muslims. So this was a problem which they did not face at the time of Rasulullah, and it was a problem regarding the answers for which there was no necessary. It is because of this, the Ansar said that they were more worthy of leadership than anybody else. Why? Because they were the ones who gave refuge to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. They were the ones who helped Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam when he required help. It was to them Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam migrated and made hijrah. And it is amongst them Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam lived and died. Thus the Ansar believed they were worthy of leadership than anybody else. Now the Muhajireen believed they were worthy of leadership more than anybody else. Why? Because they were the tribe of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Now, Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala and the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam believed that they were worthy of leadership. Why? Because they were the Ahlul Bayt, they were the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. After this problem was solved, there was, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu became Khalif, there was the problem of those Bedouins who were turned away from Islam and became Murtad. And there were people who refused to pay the zakat, which is one of the things that is compulsory in Islam. Now these people refused to pay zakat, but they believed in the kalima la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. And at the same time, they'd offer their salah. Now is it permissible for Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu to fight with these people? Yet Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, Umirtu an uqatil an-nas hatta yukulu la ilaha illallah, that I have been ordered to fight with the people till they say la ilaha illallah. And once they said la ilaha illallah, afanu minni dima'an wa anwalahum, they have saved their properties and their lives from me. Now it was a problem that the Muslims had not faced before. And no was there a verse of the Quran that said in clear words that yes, it is permissible to fight with these people, or no, it is not permissible to fight with these people. Nor was there hadith which stated, yes, it is permissible to fight with these people, or no, it is not permissible to fight with these people. Then there was a problem of whether the Quran should be compiled. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam left the world in such a state that the Quran was not compiled in the form of a book. Now should the Quran be compiled? It was a problem that they did not face at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Nor was there a verse of the Quran which said, yes, it should be compiled, or no, it should not be compiled. Nor was there a hadith which said, yes, the Quran should be compiled, or no, the Quran should not be compiled. Then there was the problem of the inheritance of a grandfather in the presence of brothers. Will the brothers also inherit with the grandfather, or will only the grandfather inherit? Yet again, there was no clear solution for this in the Quran and the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there were many, many problems like this, regarding the answers of which there was no necessary, there was no clear indication in the Quran and Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now as Muslims we believe that the Quran doesn't contain every single problem till the Day of Judgment in clear words, and the solution to every single problem till the Day of Judgment in clear words. For example, my sitting here on a chair with a mic in front of me, addressing you on a Sunday afternoon, this is not mentioned in the Sunnah of Rasulullah in the Hadith. And nor is it mentioned in the Quran. Nor is it mentioned in the Sunnah of Quran that this thing is permissible for Ahmad Ali to lecture you on a Sunday afternoon. Nor will you find this in the Quran. Now if every problem like this till the Day of Judgment was written in clear words in the Quran and Sunnah, then we would be in need of not one book or a few books. We would be in need of a billion books. Now as Muslims we believe that every principle that we require to solve any problem, that is mentioned, that is in the Quran and that is in the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when any problem arises which has been undefined by the Quran and Sunnah, we use these principles and we apply these principles to solve any problem which has been undefined in the Quran and Sunnah. And this is the belief of the Sunni Muslim. Now the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een were faced with all these new problems which they had not faced at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Problems regarding which there was no clear indication in the Quran and Sunnah that this is the solution to this problem. What did the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een do? They turned to make an ijtihad. Ijtihad is the reasoning process through which laws are deduced after thorough research. This is ijtihad. The reasoning process through which laws, Islamic laws are deduced after thorough research. So the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala an majma'in turned to ijtihad. And it was from here, at the time of Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala an majma'in, we have the third and fourth source of Islamic, of legislation, of Islamic jurisprudence. The third source was ijma. Ijma is the unanimous agreement of the Sahaba or the scholars on an aspect of deen. And qiyas, analogical deduction. So at the time of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, we had another two sources of Islamic legislation, and they were ijma, the unanimous agreement of the Sahaba on an aspect of deen, and fourth was qiyas. Now the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in didn't turn to ijtihad out of their desire. The reason the Sahaba turned to ijtihad, because the foundation of this had also been laid by Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam himself. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam himself would turn to making ijtihad when such a problem arose regarding which as yet there was no revelation. For example, at the time of the Battle of Tabuk, when the Muslims had to fight with the Kuffar, a few hypocrites came to Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and they began to ask Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam permission not to participate in this battle. Now as yet there was no revelation whether they should be given permission or whether they should not be given permission. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam made ijtihad, and through ijtihad he gave these hypocrites permission not to participate in this battle. Another example, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam made ijtihad with regard to the captives of the Battle of Badr. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam asked the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in regarding the prisoners of Badr, what should be done with them? Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, ashiratuk farasilhum. O Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, they are from your tribe, free them. While Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, uqtulhum, kill them. Now, no verse regarding these captives had been revealed. There was no revelation. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam made ijtihad and he freed the captives of Badr by taking ransom. So Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, when such a problem arose regarding which there was no revelation, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam also turned to ijtihad. Not only did Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam turn to ijtihad, he approved of the ijtihad of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. Ibn al-Qayyim relates that when Sayyidina Mu'az was sent to Yemen by Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam asked Sayyidina Mu'az, O Mu'az, كيف تصنع إن أرض لك كذا? O Mu'az, if you are faced with a problem, how will you tackle this problem? Sayyidina Mu'az ibn Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied, Ya Rasulullah, أقضي بما في كتاب الله. I will look for the answer in the book of Allah, and if I can find the answer in the book of Allah, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I will do exactly the same. This is how I will solve the problem. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam asked, فَإِن لَمْ يَكُنْ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ O Mu'az, if the answer and solution is not in the book of Allah, what will you do? He says, بِسُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ سَنَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ Ya Rasulullah, I will look in your sunnah, and if I can find a solution inside your sunnah, I will do accordingly and I will judge accordingly. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam said to Sayyidina Mu'az, O Mu'az, فَإِن لَمْ يَكُنْ فِي سُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ سَنَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ And if you cannot find the solution in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what will you do? Sayyidina Mu'az ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied, Ya Rasulullah, أَجْتَهِدُ رَأْيِي O Messenger of Allah, I will make ijtihad. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam was pleased with Sayyidina Mu'az ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He trusted Sayyidina Mu'az radiallahu ta'ala anhu and he prayed for Sayyidina Mu'az, Alhamdulillah alladhi waffaqa Rasulillah lama yurdi Rasulullah. O praise to the one who has given tawfiq to the Messenger of the Messenger of Allah to do that thing which pleases the Messenger of Allah. So not only did Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam make ijtihad, Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam approved of the ijtihad of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. So it was because of this, when the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in were faced with a problem which was undefined in the Quran and Sunnah, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in turned to ijtihad, and this is how they would solve their problems. Maymun ibn Mihran relates, كَكَانُوا أَبُو بَكْرِ إِذَا وَرَدَ عَلَيْهِ حُكْمٌ نَظَرَ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ Whenever Sayyidina Abu Bakr faced a problem, his first step was, look in the book of Allah. If it was told from the book of Allah, that's how he would rule. If the solution was not found in the book of Allah, The second step, نظر في سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. سيدنا أبو بكر رضي الله تعالى عنه will look in the sunnah of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. If he didn't possess the answer to this problem, he would ask the people, do you know whether Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام regarding this problem said anything? Sometimes the answer would be in the affirmative, and somebody would stand up and take a qada fihi bi qada wa qada. Yes, Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام was faced with a problem like this, and this is how Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام solved the problem. However, if nobody possessed the sunnah or the solution to this problem, then the hadith states, Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu would gather the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. He would gather the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, he would present this problem to them, and the Sahaba would make ijtihad. The Sahaba would make ijtihad. And if all the Sahaba came to an agreement to one solution, this became ijma, the unanimous agreement of the Sahaba on an aspect of deen. This became ijma, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu would then judge accordingly. For example, the compiling of the Quran. Now the compiling of the Quran was a problem Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu faced. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you should know that the Quran was not compiled in the form of a book as we have it today. Yes, the Quran at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had been written, and written in totality, and written in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and checked by Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam himself. But the Quran had not been compiled in the form of a book as we have it today. Now what happened is, in the battle of Yamama, many Qurra who had memorized the Quran of by heart were martyred in this battle. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu came to Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he suggested to Sayyidina Abu Bakr, O Abu Bakr, it is a good thing that it would be good if you compile the Quran, because many of the Qurra have passed away. And if the Qurra, those that have memorized the Quran, keep on dying in battles like this, then the Quran will be lost. Now this was a problem which they did not face at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Secondly, it was a problem regarding which there was no clear indication in the Quran and Sunnah that yes, the Quran should be compiled, or no, the Quran should not be compiled. So when Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was faced with this problem, he gathered the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. All the Sahaba made ijtihad, and all the Sahaba agreed that yes, the Quran should be compiled, and this became ijma. So this is how Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu would solve the problem. The Sahaba would get together, and then they would make ijtihad. If they all agreed, it would become ijma. However, if the Sahaba, after making ijtihad, could not come to an agreement, and there are many instances where the Sahaba did not agree. For example, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in differed with regards to a free woman marrying a slave. After how many talaq divorces she receives, she will become haram on this slave. Now the masla regarding a free woman marrying a free man is clear. Once a free woman receives three talaq from her husband, which is a free man, she will become haram on him. She is no longer his wife. What is the masla if a free woman marries a slave? How many talaq will she receive that she will become haram on this slave? Now the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in differed with regards to this. There were some Sahaba who would give the fatwa, Sayyidina Uthman was one of them, but after receiving two talaq, two divorces, she will become haram on her husband who is a slave. And they looked at the masala from this angle. They said, the person who holds the authority to give a talaq is the man. Is the man who gives the talaq. And the man in question here is a slave. Now a slave has the authority to give two talaq. So after this woman has received two talaq, she will become haram on her husband. Other Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, like Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, would look at the problem from this angle. And they would say that after she has received three talaq, she will become haram on him. And they looked at the masla from this angle, that it's the woman that receives the talaq. Not the man, it is the woman that receives the talaq. And the woman in question here is a free woman. And the talaq, the divorce of a free woman, is three talaq. So when this woman receives three talaq, she will become haram on her husband who is a slave. So this is just one example where the Sahaba differed. Another example where the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in differed was with regards to the waiting period of a woman who is expecting and at the same time her husband has passed away. Some Sahaba gave fatwa that any woman who is expecting and her husband has passed away, her waiting period is till she gives birth. Once she's given birth to the child that's in her womb, she becomes halal. Some Sahaba gave fatwa that no. They said there are two verses in the Quran. There is a verse in the Quran which discusses the waiting period of a woman who is expecting. And that is, أَجَلَهُنَّ أَنْ يَضَعْنَ حَمْلَهُنْ till she gives birth. When she gives birth, she has become halal. That is one verse of the Quran. The second verse of the Quran deals with the waiting period of a woman whose husband has passed away. And the waiting period mentioned in the Quran is يَتَرَبَّصْنَا بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ أَرْبَعَةَ أَشْهُرٍ وَأَشْرَى. They will wait for 4 months and 10 days. So they said that the woman in question here is expecting and at the same time her husband has passed away. So acting upon both of these verses of the Quran, this woman will wait for the latter of the two periods. Whether it is giving birth or whether it is 4 months, 10 days, acting upon both verses of this Quran, she will wait for the latter of the two periods. So these were examples where the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, after making ijtihad, differed. So when the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in differed even after making ijtihad, subhanallah, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in would not force anybody to act upon their opinion. The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in would not force the masses to act upon their opinion. And there's a clear indication of this in the hadith. A man came to Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu asked this man, كَيْفَ صَنَعْتَ? How was the problem solved? He said, this was the problem between me and my friend. And this is how Sayyidina Ali and Sayyidina Zayd solved the problem between us. Sayyidina Umar said, if I was there, I would have solved the problem, not in this manner, but in this manner. Different to the way Sayyidina Ali and Sayyidina Zayd solved it. So the man said, Umar, why don't you do it? Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu replied, that if I was solving it directly from the Quran and Sunnah, then I would have done so. But I am also making ijtihad. And Sayyidina Ali and Sayyidina Zayd have also made ijtihad. When it comes to ijtihad, we were both trying to seek the truth. And thus we are both equal with regard to making ijtihad. So this is how the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in and Sayyidina Abu Bakr would solve the problem. Sayyidina Umar came, he solved the problems exactly in the same manner. The Quran, the Sunnah, the Ijma of the Sahaba, and then Qiyas. This is how the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in would solve the problem. Now before we continue, you probably think that at the time of the Shaykhain, yani Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar, there were differences of opinions with regards to issues of fiqh, with regards to issues of jurisprudence. Yes, at the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr and Sayyidina Umar, there was difference of opinions with regards to certain issues. However, at the time of Abu Bakr and Umar, these were very less. Because majority of the problems were solved through ijma, through the unanimous agreement of the Sahaba on an aspect of deen. Because at the time of Sayyidina Umar, it was very easy to solve problems through ijma. Why? Because Sayyidina Umar had prohibited the Sahaba from leaving the capital of the Islamic State, Madinatul Munawwara. And the Sahaba were in Madinatul Munawwara. Thus, whenever such a problem arose which was undefined by the Quran and Sunnah, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu immediately would gather the Sahaba and call a meeting. And the Sahaba would make ijtihad, and normally they would agree on the solution, and thus the problem was solved. However, after the time of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu dispersed to different lands. The lands that were conquered, the Sahaba went to these different lands to convey the message and to guide the masses to the Sirat al-Mustaqim. Now it was difficult for the Khalif to gather the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in whenever such problem arose which was undefined by the Quran and Sunnah. Because some Sahabis in Iraq, some are in Yemen, some are in Damascus, and so forth. So every time a problem arose, it was difficult for the Khalif to call all these Sahaba back and to solve the problem through ijma. Because it was difficult for the Khalif to gather the Sahaba, problems thereafter solved through the unanimous agreement of the Sahaba were less. And because of this, the Sahaba made ijtihad according to the knowledge they possessed. And as a result of this, there was more different opinions. And the reason there were different opinions was, number one, تَفَاوَتُهُمْ فِي فَحْلِ مَا أُجْمِلَ مِنُ الْقُرْآنِ. The different understandings the Sahaba had regarding things which were mujmal in the Qur'an. For example, the verse of the Qur'an, وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتُ يَتَرَبَّطْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ ثَلَاثَ دُقُرُوءٍ, talks about the waiting period of a woman who has been divorced. The verse of the Qur'an says, those women that have been divorced, they will have to wait for a period of 3 quru. The word mentioned in Arabic is quru. Now this word has two meanings. It could mean haiz, menses, and it could mean tuhr, the time of purity of menses. Now some Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'een took the first meaning, and some Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'een took the second meaning. And because they have taken different meanings, the masla is going to be different. And this was a cause of different opinions. Another cause for different opinion was, تَفَاوَصَهُ فِي اسْتِمَاءِ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم, the different amount of knowledge of the sunnah each sahabi possessed. Now not every sahabi stayed with Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam at all times. And thus, they were not equal in the knowledge of the sunnah they possessed. It was possible that he who was in Iraq knew something that he who was in Yemen did not know. It was possible that he who was in Yemen knew something that he who was in Damascus didn't know. He who was in Damascus, it's possible that he knew something that he who probably in Mecca was did not know. And because not each Sahabi possessed the entire knowledge of the Sunnah, each Sahabi gave fatwa according to his knowledge of the Sunnah and to the best of his ability. And sometimes this fatwa coincided with the Sunnah, and sometimes this fatwa did not coincide with the Sunnah. And this was a cause of more different opinion with regards to issue of fiqh. And the final cause was, تَفَاوَتُهُمْ فِي الْإِجْتِحَادِ حَيْثُ لَا نَقْرِ, the different abilities of the Sahaba to make ijtihad, and the different methods and approaches they used to make ijtihad. Now for example, we've got 5 doctors in this room. Now they're all doctors in the sense that they're all qualified as doctors. But it is possible that though these people are doctors, their mentality is different, their approach is different, and their methods are different. Now the Sahaba were all qualified to make ijtihad. This is why they would make ijtihad. But at the same time, though they were mujtahid, qualified for the work, their abilities were different. And their methods were different. And their approaches were different. And I've just given you an example of this with regards to the free woman marrying a slave. Some Sahaba looked at the masla from one angle and just gave the fatwa according to the way they looked at the masla. And some Sahaba look at the masla from a different angle, and thus they gave the fatwa according to the angle they looked at to the masla. So because they had different abilities and different methods and approaches, this was a cause of different opinions with regards to issues of fiqh, issues of jurisprudence. Now at the time of Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in, I've mentioned that there were 4 sources of legislation: the Quran, the Sunnah, the Ijma, and the Qiyas. At the same time, I'd like to mention, though the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in agreed on making ijtihad, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in had two different approaches with regards to making ijtihad. There were those Sahaba who favored widespread of ijtihad in matters undefined by the Quran and Sunnah, like Sayyidina Umar Farooq. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Sayyidina Umar Farooq were the ones who carried the flag of this school of thought. And then there were those Sahaba who avoided giving personal interpretations as a general practice. Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Sayyidina Umar Farooq, was one who carried the flag of this school. Now a man came to Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar and questioned him, anil udhiya awajibatun hiya, regarding qurbani, regarding giving sacrifice, is it wajib? Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu did not make qiyas. He said, dhaha an-nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wal muslimun. But I know that the Messenger of Allah would offer sacrifice, and also the Muslims would offer sacrifice. The man repeated the question because he wanted to know the ruling. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar became angry and said, Ataqil, do you understand what I'm saying? Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam performed it, and the Muslims performed it. Another man came to him and said, I vowed that I will fast on every Wednesday. Now what should I do? The day of Udhiyah also falls on a Wednesday. And in Islam it is haram to keep a fast on that day. What should I do? He didn't make ijtihad. He just said, look, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam has ordered to fulfill your vows, and at the same time he has prohibited that you fast on that day. So we have two different approaches with regards to ijtihad.